the church say amen.
Amen.
And amen again.
Amen.
What a beautiful invitation that is. Come unto me. If you're labored and heavy burden, Jesus lifts the burden and he makes them light. What do you say?
Amen.
I tell you something. You see, sometimes when I tell you that this is the Grandstone Choir, you will not understand what I'm saying. But I want to tell you that I love the choir, I love the way you minister, and you have been an inspiration to me. And without taking anything out of school, I want to tell you something. I have been other places. And I can tell you, you are singing lustily. And we thank God for that as we continue to minister in the behalf of our God. And I can't believe it. We are almost there. And you sang as if you have just begun. So I want you to know that we appreciate that. And when you come to Grantstown, you know that we have diversity here. You didn't know that we could sing in tongues. And I can tell you, the brothers did well. Those who sang here and the one on the piano. Well, next time you have a quartet so I can give you a little of my Creole in here.
Amen.
That would be a potpourri. They wouldn't understand what that is. But it is good to be here and it's good to see you. And we know we have a number of visitors that are here, which I'll be getting into in a little while. But I just want to embrace what Pastor said earlier, and that you make sure that for the rest of our journey, you are going to give us your full support. We started well, but we have to finish well. What do you say? And we need everyone on board so that we can get over the finish line on time and in style for the Lord. What do you say? So we know you're working, and we know the brethren are praying, and those who with their friends, remember, we encourage you because friends bring friends. Amen? And the relationships that we establish are the ones that are going to keep us close together. What do you say? Amen? So I wanted to do that. Now, in the congregation, I didn't tell you, but at one point in time in my life, I thought that I would have half Bahamian and half Jamaican. Oh, I didn't tell you. I have to confess tonight. Because in the congregation, we have two beautiful women, like mother, like daughter. I'm going to invite them to stand, Janice and her daughter. She would almost be my sister-in-law. But for some reason or another, I don't know. But it didn't happen that way. But I'm happy to have you. And come on, Pastor. Come on. I want to give the daughter that gift for me to her. Amen. All right, thank you very much. It's good to have you here worshiping with us this evening at the Grandstone Seventh-day Adventist Church, right? And we trust that God will bless you as you worship here this evening. Tomorrow evening, the topic will be standing for a cause. Standing for a cause. Then on Friday, the topic will be coming in from the cold. Then on Sabbath, the seventh dip. And if you thought the other night was good, we're going to talk about the seventh dip. But tonight is the night. I told you, you have a quiz man who is trying to throw you off. I hope you knew that most of the questions were false. Because the topic for tonight is keys to the heavenly city. I tell you, you are a quiz man, you're an easy man. Keys to the city. Let us bow our heads as we pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for this night. We thank you for your goodness to us. and for all the provisions you have made so that we could be here to listen to your word. We now invoke your divine presence to be near and dear to each of us. Remove all distractions, and may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer, and let the church say,
Amen.
Keys to the heavenly city. Can I tell you? There is only one name with the power to save. There is only one name with the power to save. And that name is Jesus. Can I tell you that Jesus is our champion? Jesus is our champion. He reigns forever and ever and ever. There is no comparison with Jesus. There is none like him. There was never any like him. And there is will never be anyone like him. And one of the things that he has done before he ascended to glory, he left us a promise. He left us a promise in St. John chapter 14, reading from verse 1 to verse 3. The Bible says, he said, let not your heart be troubled. He believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms, are many mansions. But if it were not so, I would have told you. But I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there he may be also. Can I tell you that he's gone to make reservation? Because the place is already built, but he's going to make your room custom made to your taste. You didn't know. He's going to make it custom made to your taste. So he has left us a promise. And if God says something, we can bank on it. Amen. For he says, before one jot or tittle of my word fade, heaven and earth will pass away. But as we contextualize the message to our context, every valuable home today has locks and keys. Am I talking truth? And in spite of the fact that we now have to put on double padlocks, there was a time when you didn't need any grill, but you need grills. And even when you have grills, it is God that has to cover you. But every valuable home has keys, locks and keys. Well, to enter heaven, you must have two keys. So whereas provision is made for us in heaven, there are two keys that every person who desires to embrace this promise and to go home to be with Jesus, you need two keys.
Amen.
Tonight, I am here to tell you that Christ holds the keys.
Amen.
So the one who has made the promise is the one who has the keys. And not only that, but he offers them to whosoever will.
Amen.
I am happy that God is not partial. God is no respecter of persons. He loves everyone equally.
Amen.
He loves us equally the same. He has no preference.
That's right.
Let us look at one man who wanted the keys. Turn with me to the book, the Gospel according to St. John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. The Bible says in St. John chapter 3, and the verse is verse 1. The Bible tells us there was a man of the Pharisees named Nicodemus, a ruler of the Jews. Now, this was no ordinary man. He was an influential, educated man. He was chief among the Pharisees. In other words, they understood the biblical literature and were there to practice it by the letter. He was a Pharisee, ruler of the Jews. He was educated, influential, but he needed the key. The Bible says his name is Nicodemus, an educated man, a wealthy man, a high churchman. He was the chief of the ruler of the Jews, so he was a churchman. He was a churchman, but he was not a converted man. Well, excuse me. So there might be some persons who feel that because their names are on the book, it's okay. You got to be converted.
Amen.
The Bible says he wanted the keys to heaven. So I asked you the question tonight. Do you want the keys? Let me see the hands of all those who want the keys. Raise your hand. If you want the keys to go to heaven so you can receive the promise that Jesus left us. Amen. Take your hand down. The Bible tells us that the same came to Jesus by night. Watch this. Don't miss it. He was influential, educated, ruler of the Jews, but the Jews did not recognize Jesus as the Messiah. They thought that because they were from the lineage of Moses, because they were from the lineage of Moses, then that was it. They were entitled to all the privileges that God has. Well, the Bible tells us that he came to Jesus by night because he didn't want people to see him identifying with Jesus. You know, there are people like that. They want God, but they want him in secret. They don't want to identify with him in public. Well, if you want to go with Jesus, you have to be willing to own him up and stand up for him. Went to Jesus by night and said unto him, Rabbi. Watch this. In other words, Master, Teacher. We know that thou art a teacher come down from God. For no one can do these miracles that thou doest except God be with him. Then Jesus said, verse 3, instructive. Jesus answered and said unto him, Verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom. Not ready to enter yet, you know. You have to see it before you can enter it. Stay with me tonight. It is step by step we are getting there. Then, in verse 4, Nicodemus answered, questioned Jesus and said, What are you talking about? How can a man be born when he's old? Can he enter into his mother's womb the second time and be born? Remember, educated man, wealthy man, ruler of the Jews, but a simple thing. You see, he was talking about biology. Jesus was talking about theology. He was talking about biology. From a biological perspective, it was impossible, but it wasn't about man, it was about God. God was teaching him something, that in his very presence, God was with him. Amen. Now Jesus tells him of the two keys. Listen to the two keys that Jesus says. Verse 5. Verily, verily, or truly, truly, I say unto thee, watch this, except a man be born of the water, one, and of the Spirit, two, he cannot enter into the kingdom of heaven. So the first, you must be born again to see the kingdom. But to enter the kingdom, you must be born of the water and of the Spirit so that you can enter. Are you still there? Well, that is why we're going to break down for you tonight. Now, the first key is that you must be born of the Spirit. What does it mean to be born of the Spirit? At our first birth, we are born of the flesh. And the works of the flesh are carnal. No, you didn't hear what I said. All of us that are born into this life, we are born with a sinful nature because Adam and Eve sold us out. So we inherit a sinful nature. Are you with me? Yes. But I thank God for Jesus. Yes. Now go to Galatians. Which book did I say? Yes. Galatians chapter 5. Verses from verse 19 to verse 21. Though because we are born with sinful nature, born of the flesh, these are the things that we do. That is why we need to be born of the Spirit so that we can subdue these things. Are you with me? So because we're born of the flesh, these are the fruits. Verse 19. Now, the works of the flesh are manifest. So, you don't have to try to show people, or fool people, or try to deceive people. Who you are will you never see, because you will demonstrate it in the things you do. That is why I say a wolf can pretend to be a sheep, but very soon its appetite will expose it. Because wolves are not carnivores. They are not herbivores, rather. They are carnivores. In other words, they need flesh. So if they pretend to be a sheep, the sheep don't eat that. Sheep are herbivores. They eat grass. Amen? So stay with me. It says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these. What are they? Adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, obia working. And you know, voodoo worship. People people still worshiping spirits and in the church, even tonight, don't understand the power of God. Hatred, still hating. So if you're in the church, though you name me on the church book, and you're hating your brother, you are still in the flesh, and you can't enter heaven. Do you still love me?
Yes.
You better love me. Because I'm telling you the truth. And I'm telling you what the Bible says. Variance. Emulations. Wrath. Strife. Seditions. Heresies. Envying. That means bad mind. You don't like to see anybody succeed if it is not you. You can't celebrate the success of other people's children if it is not your children. It is a clear sign you are living in the flesh. Doesn't care how righteous you think you are, how pompous and sanctimonious you think you are. If these are evident in your life, you need to be baptized of the Spirit and of the water. Murderers. You know that the greatest murderers we have? Those who are murdering people with their tongues. And they see you in front of you. Oh, child, I was just thinking about you. And by the time you turn your back, they're crucifying you.
Amen.
I say, I don't need friends when I'm in the room. I need friends who, when I'm out the room, they will still be my friends.
Amen.
You know, some people can only be your friend when you are in the room, for they can't say what they want to say, and they give you a plastic smile, and they don't mean that. I don't need any plastic smile from anybody. I don't need any flimsy shake hand. Some people, when they shake your hand, it's cool and callous. It might as well they don't touch you. They can't feel any life. They don't mean it.
Amen.
Keep it. Am I talking truth?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So they murder you with their tongue. As soon as you turn your back. And sometimes if you turn around fast enough, you see that them in a... Chunkenness, revelings, and such the like. The Bible says, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Let me see all the hands of those who want to inherit the kingdom of God. All of us. So at conversion, when you are born of the Spirit, the Bible tells us that at conversion, you are born of the Spirit. And the Bible says, when you are born of the Spirit, there will be new behavior.
Amen.
New behavior. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, the Bible says, therefore, if any person be in Christ, he or she is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. What does that mean, Pastor? Break it down. It simply means that there is a radical change. Radical change. You move from somebody who hate to somebody who love. You move from a liar to being truthful. You move from a warmonger to a peacemaker. Too many warmongers in the church. We need more peacemakers. Too much susu and news carrying in the church that divides the church. I wish all of us, You know, I told you there are some persons would search a ton of dirt to find a speck of diamond. But some of us will search a ton of diamond to find a speck of dirt. And when we find the speck of dirt, we give it 100% attention. So it doesn't matter how good the person is. You don't see, you find the one negative and you gripe about it. What if all the members of the church would seek to find one positive in a person and give it 100% attention? What a church it will be. Adultery will turn to purity. Cursing will turn to praying. And you know Adventist cursing, bad word. Yes. Then we come and they tell you something. They're out there and they're talking and they say, you come and they know they hate you. So they can't tell you what they want to say. They say, brown dog. Curse them or curse you. But they can't curse you so. Because I know you will take it to church board and they will have to face it. So they talk all kind of things. Discord will turn to concord. Dance hall will give way to church hall. Sabbath breaking will give way to Sabbath keeping. Tobacco breath will give way to clean breath. Spouse beater will turn to spouse lover. And not only women getting beaten, man getting beaten too. So that is the first key. You must be born of the Spirit. So when you're born of the Spirit, people can see the change. New change in my life. People can see it because what you used to be, you are no longer. You know, there was this man going around selling cream to grow hair. And when I look at him, his head is bald. How can you be selling hair, cream to grow hair, and your hair is bald? Then I don't want that cream. Would you buy it?
No.
You must reflect the product that you are selling. If it is nutritious, you must look healthy, robust, and nice. People will gravitate and say, yes, the product is working, I need it. Well, if you are a Christian, you must make it attractive. Too many long-faced Christians like nothing good now go on for them. Excuse me, sorry. They're operating as if nothing good is happening for them. When God has been good to you, you must show the world that God is good to you. Everything may not be going well, but if you think your situation is bad, wait until you hear about Jane and Tom. You got to thank God for what God has been doing for you. Then the second key is baptism. And I thank God that this coming Sabbath, there is going to be a big baptism. God's children who are genuine in their commitment to God and recognize that the only reason that they are here is because God has shown them mercy. They are willing to repent and to go home with Him. The second key is baptism. To be born of the water equals baptism. Amen? You see that? You read that in the Word, right? Let's go. We must follow the biblical method of baptism. Hello? We can't follow what man says. I told you, you have to follow what the Bible says. Nowhere does the Bible teach that you must sprinkle. The Bible says, we must follow the biblical method of baptism, which is baptism by immersion. What is immersion? Immersion is a big word. What it is? I'm going to break it down for you. Go to the Bible. Acts chapter 8. Verses 38 and 39. The Bible says, the Ethiopian eunuch went to church and they preached from the book of Isaiah, but he did not understand. I love God. Because God always makes himself or his messengers available for those who are honestly seeking truth.
Amen.
He did it for the woman at the well. He did it for you in your time. And he's doing for us, some persons in the Mission of Mercy Gospel campaign. So they were coming from church. And the man sat in his chariot. He was the chancellor of the exchequer for Candace, queen of the Ethiopian. So, was coming home, sitting on his chariot. But he did not understand. But God sent Philip to him. And this is where I pick it up. And he commanded, because Philip asked him, understandeth what thou readest? And he said, no, how can I understand if no one interprets or no one teaches me? So, Philip, this is what happened. And he commanded the chariot to what? Stand still. And they went down both into the... Watch this. Both Philip and the eunuch, and he baptized him.
Amen.
And when they were come up out of the water, it can't be plainer, the Spirit of the Lord caught Philip, caught away Philip, that the eunuch saw him no more, and he went his way rejoicing.
Amen.
There is always rejoicing when we take our stand for God.
Amen.
It may not be a popular stand, but God will take care of us.
Amen.
Now, let's go to the book of Mark. Because the Bible is clear. Mark 16, verse 16. He says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. So if you want to be saved, you must first believe. And the Bible says, he who comes to God, or the person who comes to God, must believe that he's God. And he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. So it takes faith. Then he says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. So you can't believe only and not baptize. You can't come to the church, hear the messages, convicted, and walk away and don't baptize and believe you're going to be all right. No, why? Because even the devil believes and trembles. But you may believe, but you must put your belief into action. I'm trying to make it as simple as I can. When God delivered the children of Israel from Egypt, watch this. Some of them were baptized already. Mm-hmm. But when they were in slavery, many of them break the Sabbath. And because they broke the Sabbath, when they were coming out, God had to baptize them. Oh, you didn't see that. You didn't know that. Come with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, reading verses 1 and 2. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 1 and 2. So while they were in captivity, many of them broke the Sabbath. They were living like the pagans. So in order for God to take them the way they, remember they were God's people, God had to baptize them. Here it goes. Moreover, brethren, I would not that you be ignorant. Not knowing, he says, don't be ignorant about this. How that all, how many? All our fathers were under the and all passed through the and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea. Amen. You can't go to the promised land. If they were going to go into the promised land, then they had to be baptized. If we are going into the promised land, we must believe and we must be baptized in order to go there. Amen. They were all baptized because in Egypt, they broke the commandments and were disobedient. They were disobedient. In Romans chapter 6, let me go down there quickly, verses 3 to 5, the Bible says, baptism is the celebration of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. So baptism is not an ordinary thing. Not an ordinary thing. The Bible says it's a celebration of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus. All of that is in baptism. That's what it signifies. You must be dead to sin. You must bury the old man going under. And when you come up, you must rise to walk in the newness of life. Amen. Listen to what the text says. Know ye not that so many of us were baptized into Jesus Christ, were baptized into his death. Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death. That like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also shall walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection. And I say amen. Amen. But what else does baptism celebrate? Baptism is a celebration of your death to sin. The burial of the old way of life and the resurrection to life, to live the new life in Christ. Acts chapter 2, 37 and 38, 41 and 42, the Bible says, now when they heard this, they were pricked in their heart and said unto Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Then Peter said unto them, repent, turn from your wicked ways, and be baptized every one of you in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Amen. And he shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. So if you don't baptize, you can't receive the Spirit to dwell in you. Then the Bible says, then they gladly received his word and were baptized. Oh dear people, hard heart. Very hard. You preach out your life and you make it as simple as it can be. And it's as if people are still holding on to their way of sin. Do you know that that is a prophecy? The Bible says, in the last days, men will be lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God, having a form of godliness and denying the power thereof. So if you have one of the stop star coming here for a party, roadblock. Yeah. Don't come, Michael. You can't pass. But if it is something for God, few people want it. But broad is the way that leads to destruction, and many there be that find it. But narrow and straight is the way that leads to life, and few there be that find it. Be a part of the few. Be a part of the few. You know, a Time is almost gone. But get this one. Let me give you some examples. Is there hope for any of us? There is hope. Let's look at Paul. He received both keys. You see, you cannot see the kingdom if you're not born again. You must be experience conversion inside and demonstrate it on the outside by a baptism. So baptism is an outward demonstration of inward conversion. Now, if you tell me that you are converted in your heart, I can't see it. But when you decide to get up from your seat and walk down the front, you are showing people that while the preaching was going on, the Spirit was working in your heart, bringing conviction, and you're going to demonstrate to the devil, I choose Jesus.
Amen.
So it is your faith plus your action that will bring God's intervention in your life. Is that okay?
Yes.
So here is this man. Let's look at this churchman. Acts chapter 9, verse 1. His name is Saul. He was breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord. He went to the high priest of the day, high priest. And he got a letter to destroy the people. I told you about it already. And he was going to search out to find the Christians, those who were following Jesus, to kill them. That's, oh Lord, I wish you would see it. If you don't have God in your heart, you're going to be wicked, you know. There will be no human care or empathy for anybody. He wanted to kill them. So he had the keys to the church, but he didn't have the key to heaven. Saul had the key to the church, but he didn't have the key. He didn't have the key to heaven. So we read in Acts 9, 3 to 5, when he met Jesus, and as he journeyed, the Bible says he came to Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. From where?
Heaven.
And he fell to the what? And heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Be careful how you mess with God's people.
Amen.
For if you hurt God's children, you are hurting God.
Amen.
If you hurt God's children, you are hurting God. But sometimes we don't see it, and you may be strong and mighty. He had the key to kill people, and one little shadow of Jesus hit him down flat.
Hallelujah.
He said, who art thou, Lord? And the Lord said, I am Jesus, whom thou persecutest. It is hard for thee to kick against the pricks. You can't fight against God. Don't try to put a spoke in God's way. God will remove you. If you are a stumbling block in the way of somebody who wants to surrender to Jesus, watch it. God will remove you. Sometimes you wonder why some things happening to some people. It is happening to some people because they have been rejecting God and they are operating like they own their lives in their own hands. I take God's word seriously. Saul asks an honest question. Listen what he says. Lord, what must I do? He recognized that what he was doing was wrong. He was going against God's children and it was wrong. And when God confronted him, he said, what must I do? Saul took the first key. In Acts chapter 9, verse 17, he was born of the Spirit. Then he took the second, you know what? Let me read it so you don't say I told you and you didn't see it. Acts chapter 9, 17. The Bible says, and Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hand on him, said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus, that appeared unto thee in the way as thou camest, has sent me that thou mightest receive thy sight and be what? Filled with the Holy Spirit. He received the first baptism. He received his sight. He received the Spirit. And watch with the second one. Verse 18. And immediately, what? There fell from his eyes as it had been scales, and he received sight forthwith, and arose and was
baptized.
That is in your Bible?
Yes.
There's a special baptism I told you this Sabbath. But I can't preach and don't close this message to let you know that Paul alone didn't take it. All those disciples didn't take it alone. But Jesus himself took it. Amen.
Amen?
Saul was a good example. But the best example is Jesus.
Amen.
Do you believe that?
Yes.
Matthew, Mark. And you know that Mark is the first gospel that was written. Amen?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Yes, it's not Matthew, it's Mark. Mark is the first gospel that was written. All right, we'll talk about that another time.
Amen.
Mark chapter 1. From verse 9, the Bible says, and it came to pass in those days that Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized of John in Jordan. You see that in your Bible?
Yes.
Did you see that in your Bible?
Yes.
All right. And straightway, coming up out of the water, he saw the heavens open and the Spirit like a dove descending upon him. And there came a voice from heaven saying, thou art my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Why did Jesus get baptized? In Matthew chapter 3:13, the Bible tells us that he was baptized by John. And when John said, no, I'm not baptizing you. You should be the one baptizing me. And Jesus says, suffer it to be so, to fulfill all righteousness. So he was leaving us an example. So Jesus, the Bible says, and Jesus, when he was baptized, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him. The Spirit descended and rested upon him and said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. God will say at your baptism, this is my beloved Son, this is my beloved daughter, in whom I'm well pleased. Then you will be welcomed into the family of God, getting ready to go home to be with Jesus. Tonight, I am sure all want to go to heaven. While my singing evangelist comes and my organist comes, we all want to go to heaven. If you want to go to heaven, say amen.
Amen.
But remember, you need two keys. You need to be born of the Spirit, which is conversion. You need to be born of the water, which is baptism. How many tonight? How many tonight want to pray? Dear Lord, please give me these keys to the heavenly city. How many want to pray that prayer? Lord, please give me these keys to the heavenly city. If that is your prayer, raise your hand. And while my singing evangelist sings their theme song, I invite the church to stand. because I only have 2 minutes to do this.
Take my heart, lead me on, help me stand. I am tired.
I want to pray for somebody and with somebody tonight. I am calling for honest children of God. This is a call. You're here and you have made up your mind. This is the first call. You have made up your mind to receive more keys. You're not yet baptized, but you have made up your mind to receive more keys. Walk from where you are and come down. God bless you. Come on. Honest seekers, I'm calling to you. God bless you. Make your way. God bless you. Come on. Come on, brother. God bless you. Come on. Seriously. Come on. This is serious. This is God's invitation to somebody tonight. He's going to hold your hand. He's going to lead you. He's going to guide you. And he's going to take you safely to your destination. A boy, a girl, a man, a woman, whoever you are, this is your call. That's the first call. Is there one more tonight? The church is praying. You want to go to heaven. And you want to go with your loved ones. Mommy, you can't say love your daughter. And you are not ready and willing to encourage her to surrender to Jesus. Daddy, you can't have your son. And you have your son outside and you're on your way to glory. No, you have to lead the way. You have to demonstrate that. You got to encourage your brother, your sister, your children to surrender to Jesus. Is there one more? I know somebody's struggling. And we're going to close. This is my second call. I want to pray for somebody tonight. You're not yet baptized, not yet surrendered. But deep down in your heart, you love the Lord. And somehow God has spoken to you tonight. I want to include you in this prayer. I'm going to ask you to walk from where you are. Shake hands with the preacher and make a surrender to Jesus. And Lord, I need your strength. I need your help. I need your guidance. I can't make it without you. And tonight, I'm going to go for this prayer because I believe that prayer, you are a prayer hearing God. Is there one such person? Come on, we want to pray with you and for you tonight. Is there one more for Jesus tonight? I want to call a backslider to come. You were once walking with the Lord, but you have fallen away. And tonight Jesus is calling. Like Nicodemus, he says, you must be born again. You're asking the question, you need to be honest like Saul and ask, what must I do to be saved? I'm going to pray. Is there one more tonight? A boy, a girl, a man, a woman. For the Bible says, God knocks, he says, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hears my voice and opens the door, I will come in, I will sup with him. All we want to do for you tonight is to help you to make that first step. We just want to pray with you and for you so that God can give you the victory. I know you love the Lord. Would you like us to pray with you and for you? Come on, if you like that, come on. Come on, is there one more tonight? We want to pray for you. We want to pray for you that God will help you to make it into the kingdom before Tuesday. You know I'm going to leave you here. I want to pray for you tonight. So I'm going to walk with you. Pastor, shake her hand and welcome her as we pray this prayer. I'm not leaving my my loved ones over here.
And the night
no.
draws me
This is the
day.
Don't be ashamed to stand up for him. Come on. Is there one more to that? God bless you, man. This is serious business. God is talking to you too long for you to be holding on. It is time to give God a foothold in your life. It is time to give him the victory. Let the devil know that he's a loser, because Jesus is the winner every time. He's the conquering lion of the tribe of Judah. He can break every chain and he can set his children free. I know he has done it for countless others, and he can do it for you. I know his heart is aching tonight, because there's somebody else who needs to be included in this prayer. Brother, come. You know you belong here. Pastor's going to pray this prayer, very special prayer for these wonderful people. He's going to pray that God will grant them the victory. Is there one more tonight, a man who needs to come? Don't stay out. Don't be afraid. Turn it over to Jesus tonight. Come on. Come on. Heads are bowed, and even while your heads are bowed, the eyes closed, and pastor's praying, and you need to be here, you gotta come. And remember, I am telling you this. If you need a visit from the evangelist or the pastor, we are prepared to come. Because it's a matter of life and death. Hear the voice of Jesus. Don't wait until it is too late.
Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, as I stand here tonight, it is only because of your grace and mercy. So many times, O Lord, I could have lost my life and lost my soul. But because of your grace and mercy, your long-sufferingness towards me, why I'm here tonight. And so tonight, that is our testimony. Those who have come forward, those who are standing in the congregation, that if it were not for you, we wouldn't be here tonight. Thank you for grace. Sweet, wonderful grace. Grace that saves. Grace that takes us from the Godmost to the uttermost. Grace that transforms us. If any man or woman be in Christ, then we are brand new creatures. Lord, for those who have come forward to say, yes, Jesus, I've decided to follow Jesus, no turning back. The cross is before me and the world is behind me. I'm going all the way with Jesus in baptism. Lord, tonight heaven is rejoicing. The church is rejoicing because of their decision. I pray that you may seal their decision for time and for eternity. The devil will be trying to discourage them, but in the name of Jesus, demons will have to flee. In the name of Jesus, they will have the victory. May you break every chain of situation and circumstances from their lives that will prevent them from going forward. Lord, those who have come for prayer, Lord, you know them. You have been with them all this time, from birth, from the womb, from conception. You love them with an everlasting love, and you want to save them. Lord, I pray that your blessings will be upon them, that you will continue to speak to their hearts. Help them, Almighty God, to realize and to recognize that your way is the best way. It brings peace that passes all understanding. It brings joy that is overflowing all the time. And it gives us the assurance of salvation that we can have eternal life with you. So help them, Almighty God, to make the right decision tonight, to go all the way with you, to serve you. There are others in the congregation who did not budge, did not move. You love them. Speak to their hearts. Keep on knocking. Keep on knocking, Almighty God. There's still time. But time is running out. Soon and very soon, it will be too late. And as for us as Christians, Almighty God, as the evangelist preached tonight, didn't our hearts burn within us? We want to be saved. We slip and we fall and we fail. But tonight we stand to renew our commitment to you. To say, Jesus, we love you and we want to serve you. So whatever stumbling block is in our way, Almighty God, I pray in the name of Jesus that tonight it will be removed. Yes. And the saints will be free to serve you and to glorify you and to give you thanks. So Almighty God, may you lift us if we fall. May you hear us when we call. May you hold us in the hollow of your hand. For when people follow Jesus, we will never, ever be lost. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen.
God bless you. Love you. We're praying for you. And we want you to know that make sure we have your name so we can pray with you and support you, because we will be there to celebrate with you. God bless you. Love you. Take care.